tonight. We are very honored and indebted to three guest speakers and keynote speakers for our talk. They will come for this special discussion session with our Dudjom Buddhist Association and also the Life Enlightenment Charity Foundation. Next to my right is Dr. Peter Fenwick, and then to his right is Dr. Van Lommel, and then next to Dr. Van Lommel is Professor Haraldsson. So we will now start with some kind of questions so that they can discuss and relate to what they are doing now. Okay. The first question that I would like to put up to you is, what motivated you all to take scientific research studies on near-death experiences so seriously? And what are the reasons that has sustained your motivation to continue on with this kind of research study for such an extended period of time? So any one of you can start.
Well, I know why I started it. I read Raymond Moody's book, and that was in 1973, and that told us all about near-death experiences, how these people went down a tunnel and saw the light and so on. But I knew it was absolute rubbish. It only happened in California, and it never happened anywhere else. But I was so wrong, and I was wrong because I got a patient that had been having a catheterization of his heart. It went wrong, and his heart stopped. He left his body. He saw the resuscitation process, saw them kicking over the stools because they were doing it in the wrong place. It was some time before they got his heart restarted. And he had a full near-death experience, went down the tunnel, being of light, the wonderful area, etc. But he was so frightened and scared by it that when he came back, he had a post-traumatic stress syndrome, acute anxiety. And he was referred to me with acute anxiety. So I couldn't say it occurred in California. It didn't. It occurred also in the room that I was in. And so that meant that I had to then look into it, and that's exactly what I did.
Yeah, for me, it started as a young doctor in 69, in the first years of resuscitations, that you had a patient who successfully was resuscitated after a spell of unconsciousness of about 4 minutes. And we were so happy as nurses and a doctor that we succeeded. It was the beginning of resuscitation. And the patient was extremely disappointed and told me something about the tunnel and the light and music. I never forgot it, but I didn't do anything with it because I didn't know anything about near-death experience. I didn't know anything about the possibility to experience consciousness when you are a cardiac arrest, because to our current medical knowledge, it's impossible to experience consciousness, let alone enhanced consciousness, where your heart stops. So only in 86 I read a book about near-death experience by George Rich in Return from Tomorrow, who had a near-death experience as a medical student. And I also remembered the 69 patient. In that period in between, I've never heard a patient telling me a near-death experience. Well, as a cardiologist, we had a lot of patients who survived cardiac arrest, because he didn't ask it. I wasn't open for it. And after reading the book by George Ritchie, I just started systematically all patients who survived cardiac arrest to ask if they remembered something of the period of unconsciousness. And to my big surprise, within 2 years, out of 50 patients, 12 patients told me about the near-death experience. And that started my scientific curiosity, because according to our current knowledge, it is impossible to experience this kind of consciousness when the heart stops, the breathing stops, and the brain stop function stops. So that was the reason to start a scientific study. And when you hear so many patients tell the near-death experience to me, it's so emotional, so intriguing that you just can't stop it. Mm-hmm.
So, well, I haven't really studied much near-death experiences. I studied primarily visions that people have near the time of death. And along with them were some deathbed experiences. But these visions near the time of death, they have some characteristics that have something in common with near-death experiences. But how I started this, I was asked or invited to do it. It was not my initiative. Rather, when Kali Solsis was planning a great study on death visions, he invited me if I wouldn't like to work with him on that study. So that is how I got involved in it. Mm-hmm.
But what sustained you all to continue on for so long?
Well, I didn't really continue on with it. We just completed the study. Okay. It was a great study. It took a long time. Mm-hmm. And then we wrote about it, a paper and a book. And with that, really ended my involvement with death positions per se, or near-death experiences. But then I got involved in other studies that relate to life after death, or may relate to that, like a study of children who claim to remember past lives. And then I did, on my own initiative, a large survey of people's experiences of the dead, or encounters with the dead. But that was completely on my own initiative. But my study of children remembering past lives, I was interested in it, but I got involved in it because Stevenson invited me to make such a study. Mm-hmm. He had at the time been doing such studies alone for almost half a century. And he was keen to get someone, some independent person, also to study cases. So he invited me, along with two others, to make an independent study. Mm-hmm. And that I did first in Sri Lanka, and then later in Lebanon. And so I began with, at the initiative of Ian Stevenson, but then I continued on my own. So it lasted much, much longer than what Stevenson and I had in mind in the beginning. Mm-hmm.
Yes. How about you two? Anything to add on?
Well, the reason why I continued with the studies was that I'd become intrigued with it with my first case. And then there was a lady in the UK called Margot Gray. She was doing her MD thesis, or PhD, I think, in Guy's Hospital. And she was finding lots of cases. And so I came to understand about the near-death experience. And in 1987, a film producer asked me if I'd like to make a film on near-death experiences. And it was rather unusual, because usually with films they chop between people like this, particularly the academics. But in this one, because there weren't any other academics in the UK, I presented the whole film. And the result of that was that we got 2,000 letters. Now, in those days, people wrote letters. They didn't email or anything like that. It was all letters. And so we looked at these letters, and I could see immediately that the near-death experience was something which was really very wide. It occurred in lots of situations. It occurred in cardiac arrest. It occurred in illness. It occurred in accidents when people were extremely frightened. It occurred spontaneously when people were having mystical transcendental states. Some of these states were actually near-death experiences. And it also occurred when people were quite relaxed. And so the first thing that showed me was that you couldn't really understand near-death experiences because the brain states were so different in which they were arising. So the first point was to try and keep the brain state the same. And the way that we did that was to argue that in cardiac arrest, then you were unconscious, the brain was non-functional, and did people have near-death experiences in cardiac arrest? Well, in our series of letters, about 10%, I think it was 9% of people had experiences during cardiac arrest. And if this is true, it became enormously interesting, because it meant then that consciousness and the brain weren't necessarily linked, and so we were looking at something different. And so Sam Parnia, who was a young house officer in Southampton, decided that he would, following really what Pim had been doing in Holland.
Who started in 88.
Who started in 88. So we were late on the scene from that point of view, because we didn't start until, I suppose, probably 89, 90. So Pim was really the first one who was doing it, and Pim had come to England and talked about it. So there was sort of in the air the idea that cardiac arrest was the way to go. And so we did the Southampton study, or Sam did, and yes, we found, depending on how you defined it, but let's say roughly 7 to 10% of people with near-death experiences. And the interesting thing is they were all the same. But then the really interesting question for me was that if people really could have a near-death experience when the brain was not functioning, it meant the brain and consciousness weren't the same. And so it also meant something else, and that was that maybe if you're clinically dead as you are in a cardiac arrest, maybe this was the beginning of the death process itself. And so there were two arms to this. Sam set up the AWARE study, which is a study looking at the out-of-body experience in cardiac arrest to try and fix that so we can time the experience. And the other one, which I'm involved with, is the actual dying process, because it seemed as if this was a good model for it. And so we've done some work on the actual dying process itself, and the prediction was that people would have during the time they're dying, the beginnings of the dying process, which would be an entrance into this sort of realm they see in the near-death experience. And that's exactly what we found. Tim?
First of all, I totally agree with you, Peter, you know. But for me, so when we had this kind of pilot study from 86 to 88, with the 50 patients, 12 of them told me the near-death experiences. The question for me was the scientific curiosity that until that moment there had been a lot of retrospective studies where they had the belief that it could be lack of oxygen to the brain, hallucination, dreams, false memories, drug effects, etc. But it had never been really scientifically studied. So we started the cardiac arrest group. Well, I'm a cardiologist, so we had a lot of patients. Yes. So we started in 88, a prospective study. After 4 years, we had 344 consecutive patients who survived for cardiac arrest. And we did all the medical circumstances, the duration of unconsciousness, the duration of cardiac arrest. We noticed given medication, if they had fear of death, and other demographic factors. And we found in this study that only 18%, 62 patients, had memories of the period of unconsciousness, and 82% did not. And when we compare these two groups, with and without NDE, all survivors of cardiac arrest, to our big surprise, they were totally the same. There was no difference at all in the duration of unconsciousness. When you had cardiac arrest during rhythm disturbances in the cath lab, they're mostly resuscitated within 30 seconds. When you have a cardiac arrest in a cardiac care unit, it takes usually 2, 3, 4 minutes before they start or out of hospital arrest, it takes even more. But the duration of cardiac arrest, 2 minutes or 8 minutes, duration of unconsciousness, 5 minutes or 3 weeks in coma, didn't make any difference at all. They give medication, fear of death before the arrest. Foreknowledge that you know that it is possible to have this kind of, didn't make any difference. The religion, if you were atheist, agnostic, or Christian or Muslim, didn't make any difference at all. Education. So what we found in these two groups were totally exactly the same. So when you are looking for an explanation for the cause of the NDE, we could say there's no scientific explanation at all. It's also support effect that people can have a near-death experience in let's say without any first course in depression, in just in illness, in meditation, just what Peter said. So it was supporting the idea that there is no explanation for having a death experience. But the other thing is, it's also what Peter was mentioning, that when you have this enhanced consciousness during cardiac arrest, we know that there is no blood going to the brain within seconds. You lose consciousness within seconds. The body reflexes are gone, which is a function of the cortex. The brain stem reflexes are gone. The breathing is gone, the respiratory center is close to the brain stem. So the clinical findings are the loss of the function of the cortex and the brain stem. And then you, when you have measured the EEG, electrical activity of the cortex, which is done in other studies, not in our study, with a patient with induced cardiac arrest. There you see that within an average of 15 seconds, there's a flatline EEG. And all patients in our study had been resuscitated 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes after the start of the cardiac arrest. Nobody was resuscitated within 20 seconds or 15 seconds. So all those patients in our study and other studies like the study of St. Pauli and Peter Fenwick missed the effect of flatline EEG. So no function of the brain at all. And they still had enhanced experience, and enhanced consciousness. And this raises the question, what is the relationship between the brain function and consciousness?
Okay, let me ask another question. That the suggested idea of the consciousness being independent of the brain, or called non-local consciousness, is revolutionary in the scientific field and in the medical profession. It won't be surprised that certain number of scientists or physicians object to it. What are their major arguments against it, and what are your responses?
Well, I can start to answer, Peter can answer it as well. I think the main objective for most physicians is ignorance. They don't know anything about their death experiences. They don't never talk to a patient who had a death experience. But as I was raised in the university, I learned always that consciousness is a product of brain function. And this never proven hypothesis is accepted by most neuroscientists and other scientists and physicians as well. But it is a never proven hypothesis. And by doing the studies about the death experience in cardiac arrest patients, you should again question this never proven hypothesis, because when this hypothesis would be right, that consciousness is a product of brain function, that the near-death experience should be impossible, because when the brain function stops in there, when you have this hypothesis, there should be no possibility to experience consciousness at all. So there has always been said it is just brain function by all these physicians. But they don't know the studies that have been done about that experience in cardiac arrest patients. They have prejudice and ignorance. And that's for me the explanation. And I never try to convince other scientists or physicians that I'm right. I'm just always asking questions. How they can prove their concepts, and they cannot.
Yes, that's certainly true. I agree with very much with what Pierre was said. The interesting thing about the cardiac arrest study is this question, are mind and brain the same? It actually doesn't matter which component of brain function you take, you can never see consciousness. We can see alterations in activity. But again, it depends on the method you use. For example, the alterations can be in oxygen uptake of the brain, or it can be in the electrical activity of the brain, or it can be in the spread of activity in the brain. All these things can be related to consciousness. And we have now a neuroscience which is absolutely superb at looking at different mental states, what goes on when you think, when you lie, when you image, when you see things, feel things. We can get the whole whole range of correlations and changes in brain function, but nowhere within that, just nowhere, is the relationship between consciousness or is the actual consciousness itself. So these are all called, and everybody accepts it, they're called correlates of consciousness. And so you don't see consciousness, you just see the consciousness, the correlates of it, the effects of it. And I think even more important than that is that the range of consciousness is not fully understood. Okay, people are happy to take confusional states, they're happy to take daytime waking states, they're happy to take the onset of sleep, dreams, those sorts of states. But when you start studying the very wide states of consciousness, you realize that our view of the world is very limited. It's very, very small. It's just a little peephole. And the people that have these very wide states become universal. Their feelings are quite different. The experience of that state in itself changes you in a very marked way. And your question related to the idea of non-locality. Now, non-locality is what you see in these transcendental states where everything is in fact linked together. And that's exactly where what quantum mechanics tells us. And Pim will tell you more about this. But the concept is that if you disturb an atom in one part of the universe, it will in fact radiate throughout, because these are in fact waves, not particles. So the whole universe is connected together. Therefore, you can expect action at a distance. And the relationship between causes and effects becomes very dense indeed when you have these multiple causes going on, and it isn't in fact like Newtonian mechanics at all. So this whole idea of linking together becomes absolutely crucial. And this is what people say. They say that in fact they are everything. Now all that is saying is that their consciousness is wide and they're perceiving this linking together of different parts of themselves. Now your question asked, what do our colleagues think? Well, they think rubbish. they think rubbish because they haven't studied transcendental experiences. They think rubbish because they cannot see a connection between ordinary daytime consciousness and these wider states. They think that there's some form of pathology, which they're not. They are, in fact, about 30% of people will have weak transcendental states, 10 will have very deep transcendental states. So it's a whole area of experience they haven't had. If you haven't experienced something, you tend to say it doesn't exist, and that's why they do.
Yes.
But it's fine.
But I can add perhaps something that physicians ask them, what is the function of the brain for experienced consciousness? And then people say, consciousness is not a product of brain function. Mm. So the brain has not a producing function, but a facilitating function. It makes it possible to experience aspects of consciousness. It is normally your waking consciousness, which is only a part of this enhanced or non-local consciousness. When you experience this enhanced consciousness, there is no time and no space. Mm. Yeah, what Peter said, everything is connected always, the past and the future are available in this dimension.
I think that's another very important point there. Is that when one is considering consciousness, the fact that people can share consciousness, and in fact it's not just something which is limited to us, it is in fact something which people can share. And this aspect of consciousness tends to be neglected.
When people have had their death experience, then they have experienced an interconnectedness with the past, with the future, with deceased relatives, with the whole universe. And when they come back into their body, they still can have this feeling of interconnectedness with the whole universe, with other people, with nature, with the planet Earth. So they still have the possibility to enhance these aspects of enhanced consciousness.
Yes, and I think, Alanda, you have examples of this connectedness too, with your apparitions between people who are dying and the apparition appearing to somebody else.
Among apparitions, there are many that take place at the time of death. Is that what you're referring to?
Yes.
Yes. If you take a large sample of cases of apparitions, then you will find that about every seventh apparition appears about the time when someone dies. So the person becomes aware of that this person is dying or has just died. And often they will have this experience of persons whom they had not expected to die or did not know they were in any danger of dying. And that is a remarkable thing about it. So yes, there's a lot of that. That's very common. And are very striking, and often people are very surprised by it. And sometimes even you, through this apparition, you come to know how the person perhaps died, or through what sort of accident or whatever it is. So that's a very interesting thing. And there are more apparitions taking place on at the time of death than at any other day in the year. And that is something that was first discovered, well, some 130, 40 years ago now. And it really doesn't matter where you make surveys, you get the same results. Like in Britain, in the late 19th century, now we did our survey in Iceland 100 years later, and we get practically the same results. A number of these apparitions occurring at the time of death, and a number of apparitions also of persons who died violently, and a number of these vertical apparitions, namely that these visionary experiences, they have a kernel of truth in them. There is some veritas, there's something correct and right in the vision. It's not just an hallucination. Well, maybe I can also come a little back to the deathbed visions. The deathbed study that Callison Osis and I made together, we were very interested in finding potential causes for these visions or for these hallucinations. So we asked more than I think anyone has done before or after, what about the drugs or the medicine that people were receiving at the time when they had their apparition or had their vision? And we found that a relatively small percentage of those who had these experiences were under the effect or potential effect of some drugs that on occasions causes, can cause hallucinations, but do not necessarily do so. And then relatively few of them had high fever, which sometimes may cause hallucinations. And quite few of them were suffering from diseases that are likely sometimes to produce hallucinations. And then there was really only one potential cause left, and that was the lack of oxygen. And that is very hard to assess or to ask physicians or nurses about. But we have some other evidence for it. For example, there has been done a lot of research in aviation medicine on the effect of lack of oxygen on pilots. And it has been done, results of studies of spontaneous cases when pilots lose oxygen, but also experimental studies. And they show that they maybe through lack of some disturbances in the periphery of the visual field, but there is no instance where they have been seeing deceased persons like we have in deathbed visions. And I had the good fortune to come to into contact with the leader of the Institute for Aviation Medicine for the United States Air Force, and they made a study in their database, and they didn't, there were many studies, and they didn't find one case in which lack of oxygen had caused hallucination of a deceased or a dead person. So that sort of rejected somewhat, at least, the lack of oxygen hypothesis is often proposed and brought forward as an explanation of both this and also near-death experiences.
So this study supports the studies we did in cardiac arrest patients, that lack of oxygen in the brain is not the explanation for these enhanced consciousness.
Since the interesting issue of the quantum mechanic relation between quantum mechanics and consciousness was brought up by Dr. Fenwick a moment ago, I would like Dr. Van Lommel to elaborate a little bit about what's the relationship.
Well, we will not go into depth. I'm not a quantum physicist myself, but one of the main aspects is that you can prove in the famous splits experiment that light behaves as particles. And you can prove that light behaves like waves.
Yes.
And both is true, which is impossible. So depending of the consciousness of the experimenter who makes the experiment and where he measures the effect of the experiment, decides the result of the experiments. So primarily the consciousness of the experimenter makes the result, and which this is called complementary aspects of the same. So light is can be behave as particles and as waves, which is impossible in the classical physics. The other aspect of quantum physics is what also Peter mentioned, is the non-locality. It's the theorem of Bell, which said that two particles from one same source going out, even to a distance of 52 kilometers, where you change one particle in the magnetic field, the other particle will change instantaneously without time, which means that Einstein was wrong. He said that a spooky accident distance, that it seems to be a spooky action of this. There is a non-local correlation without time and space between two particles, which means that there are, even at a distance of 52 kilometers, what we could measure, there is an interconnectedness.
Because it goes faster than light.
Because it goes faster. It's instantaneous. So this is not about consciousness. Consciousness is that the result of the experiment is dependent of the consciousness of the experiment. And the quantum physicist said that you as the scientist are a part of the experiment and a part of the result, which was not true for Newtonian physics.
Yes, and the important point there is that this has been known since the early part of the last century, that the world is quite different from a Newtonian mechanical world. But the difficulty is that the understanding of what this actually means has not really caught up with science in general. The point which everybody makes is that quantum non-locality really only occurs when particles are very small or traveling very fast, and you don't see it in the ordinary everyday world. Now, the interesting thing that's happening in science is that quantum effects are moving out of that sphere. When we first looked at this, everybody said the brain is too hot, it's too wet, you'll never get quantum effects in it. Now, there are various arguments that the dynamics of the membrane of some cells will allow quantum effects. So it may be that the brain acts as a quantum computer. And as soon as you say that, then you're linking brains together, because these are non-local effects. The next point is that if it's a non-local computer, then its mode of action is quite different. It's not just the causality of action potentials traveling down nerves. It means that the whole of the brain substance is really has to be looked at as a whole, and it works in that way, so it works differently. And in just the field which I was in, we always thought that to get quantum effects, one had to cool down the magnetometers I use. Magnetometers are something for measuring magnetic fields, by liquid helium. Mm-hmm. But now people have found materials where you can do it at much higher temperatures, the temperatures of liquid nitrogen. Mm-hmm. There's a suggestion, in fact, that you're soon going to be able to get materials which will show quantum effects on a massive scale at even higher temperatures. So the whole of science that we thought was only for the very small and the very cold looks as if it may be wrong. And so the idea that, in fact, quantum mechanical effects may occur in the brain, it's now well on the scientific map.
Perhaps not even in the brain, but in the whole body.
Absolutely.
And each cell. So each cell has a non-local connection with its kind of some aspects of consciousness. That's at least a possibility.
Yeah. And the reason why that is such an interesting idea is that if you have people in these wider states of consciousness, transcendental states, they will tell you, every cell in my body is conscious.
Exactly.
And so if one likes to be a scientist and be driven by the data, that's what the data is. So we need to incorporate it into our theory.
Actually, the traditional Chinese philosophy is they basically said that this human body is a small universe which is totally connected with the big universe that we have. So we are all connected in that kind of a
situation. Which is not the science we have in the last three centuries. Mm-hmm. The science in the last three centuries is materialistic.
Mm-hmm.
But what you can measure, what you can objectify, this is the reality.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is with consciousness, you cannot measure, you cannot object. It's about subjectivity.
Mm-hmm.
So when we discuss these things like near-death experiences, deathbed visions, after that communication, whatever you were talking about, then you have to include subjectivity, which is consciousness. And the problem for most scientists that's also reluctant to believe is that you cannot measure it. It's just a subjective story. So we have to change consciousness, and I think quantum mechanics is helpful to change this, the science.
Yes, I think that's absolutely right. Who was it? The astonishing hypothesis. Was one of the people who discovered DNA.
Yeah. I know the name.
But his argument was that everything, but everything, is in fact just brain function.
Frick.
No. It was the other one. No, I don't think it was Crick. I think it was the Watson.
Watson.
Yes. His argument was that the whole brain, in fact, creates everything. Now, the interesting thing about that idea is that neuroscience is coming very close to that. What it's saying is that brain function makes models of our reality, and there's good evidence that it does, because if you don't teach a brain something, it can't see it. So we have to learn everything. So the information has to come in, be ordered, and then it can come into consciousness. So it means then that the brain is there to produce, to allow, if you like, forms to arise. Now, you have a great difficulty then, because there are whole sets of forms that we don't know anything about, but yet they will arise. So the argument either is that the brain can exist in these different states, or a much better one is that the forms are somehow outside the brain. You go into Platonic ideas where you have the ideal forms outside, it's transmuted. Or you go to the William James idea that the fact that the brain is it's a reducing substance of some sort. And it's, what it does is it limits perception. And you have some very nice ideas where you talk about radios and what happens.
Mm-hmm. Well, if to understand this concept about this non-local consciousness or enhanced consciousness and the brain, I would love to compare it with our modern computers or with telephone or radio or television. So a TV camera transforms vision and sound into electromagnetic information. And a TV set receives this electromagnetic information and transforms it into vision and sound. And it's also the same for telephone. That at this very moment, perhaps 500,000 telephone calls go through the walls in this room. We don't know. We can only perceive it when we have put on our mobile and we can receive just one call. And the voice we hear on the telephone is not in your telephone, but received by it. And the concert in your radio is not produced by your radio, but received by it. And you have more than 1 billion websites. You can see. Perceive everywhere in the world at about the same time. And obviously, all those billion websites are not produced by a computer, but are received by there. So, but you also can send information into the web. So, like the brain, I compare the brain with a transceiver, a sender receiver.
Yeah.
And that's how people can understand this, yeah. The function of the brain.
So, the brain
or
is pretty much.
Function of each cell.
Mm-hmm. So the brain is pretty much a tool that we can use.
A facilitator.
Yeah, a facilitator.
Right.
Yeah. And in fact, what Peter just mentioned, we have a saying in the Buddhist literature saying that everything comes from the mind.
Yeah.
That with all kinds of things, the whole universe can be coming from our consciousness.
That's very much what neuroscience says at the moment.
Okay.
And the other thing which is interesting about that, and there is still discussion on it, and that is that much of what we do, we don't do. And that is because you can show that the seeds of action are unconscious within the brain. They have to generate or grow before they come into awareness. And one of the arguments is that it is deep within us that the cause of the action is, and it, by the time it comes into consciousness, it's too late for us to do anything about it. Now, the interesting point about that was, okay, well, it comes into consciousness, surely we can stop it. And so we don't have free will because the cause is buried deep within us and then comes to late stage into consciousness. So you see it in consciousness and then you stop it.
Yeah.
Okay. And then somebody did an experiment asking, well, when does the process of stopping start? And this also is hidden deep within us and then slowly comes up into consciousness. Mm-hmm. So we can't even have free stopping. So we don't have free will and we don't have free stopping. So the idea then in neuroscience is that these things are coming up and are generated by the brain, and we attribute them to ourselves. We attribute them to ourselves the whole time, so we claim them as ourselves. But yet there is really no self there that claims them, except it's another model. And so neuroscience is really becoming enormously interesting.
When you say this, you mean your waking consciousness or your enhanced consciousness doesn't have free will?
Now, enhanced consciousness is quite a different matter.
Yeah, exactly. That's the reason I asked this.
Yes.
People could believe that what you're talking about is the enhancement. It's just about the waking consciousness, the physical aspects of consciousness. That's what you're talking about.
That's the only thing that neuroscience can measure. But the wider states of consciousness are
the correlation activity they can
yes.
measure. Not, not the content of consciousness, you cannot measure it.
No, you can never tell that.
No.
Because it's subjective and not objective.
Now, some near-death experience survivors have significant changes in their personality and it is exemplified in the video of Dr. Fenwick's presentation last Sunday. Now, the subject was an air traffic controller, seemed to have been enlightened, so to speak, and to understand the reality of the universe. So from a psychological or medical point of view, how would you explain this kind of situation?
Pim, you did a study. In your study, you looked at...
Yes. So the study we did, we started in 1988, we had the prospective part to see if we could explain the cause or content of the NDE. The other study we did was a longitudinal study with interviews after 2 years and 8 years of all survivors of cardiac arrest who claimed to have an NDE. And a matched control group of patients who survived cardiac arrest without any memory. And we did this study to see if the transformation, which you hear from patients who had a near-death experience, which is the loss of the fear of death, a new insight in life, what is important to life, unconditional love, empathy, compassion toward yourself, which is the most difficult part perhaps, to accept your own dark sides, empathy towards others and toward nature, toward the earth. And the third thing is the enhanced intuitive sensibility. That means that when they come back, they still have perhaps a lower threshold or an enhanced perceptibility that they still can receive aspects of consciousness of others. So they still feel connected with other people. They feel connected with nature. And that's the reason some people say it's an experience of oneness. The interconnectedness is always there. And what we try to find out if this transformation was due to the cardiac arrest itself, which is possible, or due to the NDE. And what we found is three elements of transformation was absolutely just statistical significance for patients who had an NDE. Let's say that they are far more spiritual, and the people without an NDE were less spiritual during the time. There were also patients who had a cardiac arrest without any, had some transformation. They're totally different as patients with an NDE. So that proves for me that this objective part of the study for subjective experience proved that this NDE only happened in those patients who had memories.
It's an enormously interesting subject, and I absolutely agree with what Pim says. Think of it this way. Think of the consciousness enhancing properties of the NDE. What is it, 1 million Americans or?
9 million Americans.
9 million Americans.
20 million people in Europe, according to surveys from Germany and the United States, which says about 4% of the general population had these kind of experiences.
And so they've all stood in the light. They've all experienced this universal consciousness. Think of the transformative powers that that has. And the really important part is that point is that once you have actually stood in the light and you have experienced these very wide states of consciousness, as Pim was saying, you are a different person. And it's a fountain of creativity. It's a fountain of new capacities within yourself. And there are good descriptions of this in the literature. These people, as Pim was saying, are more sensitive. Some of them have particularly psychic gifts. A lot of them, after they come back from their near-death experience, feel they have something to do, although they're not always clear what it is, but they know that they have something to do. And it's the transformation of their personalities, isn't it? The fact that they've become much more loving, much more social, much more spiritual people. And this is so important for our culture. Now, should we, in fact, organize it so that everybody has a near-death experience? No, of course not. You can't do that. But what you can do is you can recognize the importance of these mental states, allow them to be talked about, and allow people who have them to show the real benefits of them, rather than to have to keep it to themselves and keep it hidden all the time. And I think that my own view, but this is only my own view, is that as our culture goes on, transformations like this are going to become much more common. Because we were talking about interconnectedness and what is happening in this planet. What is it? Facebook has 800 million people. I mean, it's a huge group of people who can all act together in a coordinated way. Pim was talking about the World Wide Web and the fact that we now can't be single people. Yes, you can if you're in a small village in Iceland, possibly. Or you can if you're in a small village in India or somewhere like that. But once you have a connection with the World Wide Web, whatever you do becomes global property. And I don't know if any of you saw when Kim Jobs died, the Apple logo, you remember, it's got a bite out of it, yeah. And this guy just puts Jobs' face on it.
Yeah.
And he wasn't wanting to make money, he was just putting it onto a site. And suddenly everybody saw the truth of this, and it spread worldwide like that, it went viral.
Mm-hmm.
And this sort of resonance within the community is something which is quite different. It's never happened before.
Mm-hmm. The kind of energy they produce.
Absolutely. And so I think that sort of energy is very close to the type of energy that people have when they get transcendental experiences. I think we're going to find many more people with them.
I would love to add something. You told me about a patient who had post-traumatic stress syndrome.
Yeah.
The problem is, in our Western society, the near-death experience is not accepted by doctors, by nurses, by family members, by partners. So having this positive experience, you cannot share it with others. You are reluctant to believe it and accept it yourself, let alone you can communicate with it. And it takes mostly years and years to be able to do it. So it's a trauma as well. It has been depression, homesickness, loneliness. You feel lost about this experience, which they cannot share with others. There was a study done in the Netherlands by another psychologist that after an average of 24 years, still half of the patients who went into that were not able to communicate this experience with others.
Mm-hmm.
And still half of them, I will talk about it tomorrow as well, had the problem that they still did not experience unconditional love in earthly relationships. So it's still a problem. There are positive aspects,
yeah.
But it's very hard in this West society to get it accepted, because what you experience is also totally unexpected by yourself. It doesn't fit your own concept. And have had some physicians who had a near-death experience and said, what happened to me? I've always said, this is totally impossible. But that's the problem. So people cannot accept it.
Yeah.
Kim's absolutely right, and as a psychiatrist, I've had a number of patients who have been seriously, I was going to say damaged, but it's the wrong word, have been
traumatized.
Yes, that's right, have been traumatized by the experience. First of all, people who want to go back to it, and we've had patients who wanted to commit suicide, to get back to it again. And there are other patients who miss it so much that they become profoundly depressed.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think this is exactly what Pim says. They have physicians, in fact, who can't deal with it.
No.
They don't really fully understand it. And because I have an interest in near-death experience, I used to be referred to these cases in the UK. And so we become quite used to taking this up and helping people with near-death experiences. So I think they are very powerful experiences, and people do get changed by them, and some people need help to accommodate this change into their personality. So although there are a lot of huge benefits, you also have to be aware that some people, in fact, find it very difficult to understand and take on the new state that they've come into.
Perhaps I can add one thing, that the partner doesn't understand the change of the person. So more than 50% get into divorce because it's not the same person I was married for 20 or 30 years. Mm-hmm. Such an essential change in personality traits. You've got the change, they're not interested in money anymore, they're interested in to help people, etc. It's not only the physicians, but also family members, friends, and partner don't accept this change.
And that's important. Yeah. So it means that when you think about near-death experiences, you must think about counseling services.
Exactly.
Now, we ran for some time groups in the UK. In fact, after our film, we had so many people with near-death experiences, and they were all saying, what are these things we want to talk about, We set up groups for people, and people came to the groups, but we found something really very interesting there, and that was that once the people had come to a group and spoken about it, and come to terms with it, they didn't want to come back to another group. They'd done the work.
Yes.
And so, if one is trying to introduce people to near-death experiences, you have to have these services on hand. Okay. So if you're going into places where the near-death experience is not known, you have to have counselors. You have to have groups for ordinary people who can come and talk about it. There must be the possibility of mutual support, mm-hmm. which flows from the groups.
Studies on NDE, deathbed vision, reincarnation, aberration, and so on, have suggested the possibility of the continual existence after death, or simply called life after death. Now, are those research studies that have been done so far scientifically significant and sufficient enough for us to make such kind of a claim? And if not, what further studies might be needed in order to further substantiate this kind of claim?
There was something there at the beginning that I agreed to. What did you say? Suggested the possibility of continued existence after death. I think that is correct. Some of these phenomena, they suggest the possibility of continued existence after death. But we cannot say that they have proved it. And then also, there are different kinds of proofs. The evidence is suggestive, definitely that. But scientifically speaking, it would not be a proof. But individually speaking, for the person, some person concerned, it might be a proof, so that they do not question life after that. So there is a, there are sort of different ways to approach this, but there is not a scientific proof of life after death. Mm-hmm. But increasing evidence, I would say, at least for those who care to know about this research, and this research is then in several different fields, like there is something about like near-death experiences. There are about deathbed visions. There is in mediumistic communications, and perhaps even terminal lucidity. And of course, in studies of like children who claim to remember previous lives. So there are different avenues of evidence, and what is interesting is that maybe until the 18th, early 19th century, we only had religious beliefs or something that was brought to us from previous generations, some concepts and so on. But there was nothing empirical in it, so we either believed it or we didn't believe it, or we were somewhere in between. But now, since the latter part of the 19th century, we have been finding phenomena which we have been able to investigate empirically, And now we have some empirical data that suggest the life and death. So this has, in my view, radically changed the situation. We no longer are dependent only on religious beliefs, but we have some scientific evidence from more than one source that suggests that we may indeed live, continue to live after we die. Or rather that there is perhaps no real death, it's just our consciousness, our awareness moves from one state to another, or one kind of existence to another. So, that's what I see it. But then there is also the opposite view, of course, that when you take each of these different kinds of experiences, someone will always come up with a criticism of it, that there is some false assumptions being made, for example, about near-death experiences. Well, these people never died, they were always living, so why is it evidence for that there may be something beyond? So there are always different views, but I think on the whole we are getting closer and closer to something very important, and we are finding more and more evidence that is suggestive that life may continue after death.
I would love to add something about near-death experiences, because I totally agree with you, there is no scientific proof of a continuity of consciousness. But when you do the studies with cardiac arrest patients, there is a scientific proof that they have an enhanced consciousness when the body and the brain doesn't function anymore. And this has been a scientific proof, which means that you can experience consciousness without a body. So people who had a near-death experience say, I can live without my body, but my body cannot live without me. So they say, you have a body, and you are conscious, and just death is the end of the physical aspects, and death is just a changing state of consciousness. But it is an inevitable conclusion, highly probable, but not a scientific proof, and we will never be able to prove this continuation of consciousness. Just people who had this experience, as you said, are just convinced that there is no death.
Yes, my field, end-of-life experiences, are very much like this. In fact, if you look at the dying process, what you see is that, particularly when deathbed visitors come, that the dying language changes. It changes from they're going to die, although they don't often talk about that, but there is the unwritten assumption that it is the end of everything. But when deathbed visitors come, and they say they're going to come back and pick them up, and because the deathbed visitors are dead relatives, they're very happy to see them, they're very happy to go with them. And so their language changes to, when I leave here, when I'm going, when I'm picked up. So there's a huge change in them. Then there is the changing consciousness of the dying, when they go to this other reality, which is a spiritual reality, where they see deathbed visitors, and very much like the near-death reality. And so, if you really want to know what's going to happen when you die, ask the dying, and they'll tell you. The dying are fairly convinced that, in fact, there is a continuation after death. And we've had one or two examples, and they're perfect ones. My mother, went one writer, never believed in life after death. She was absolutely convinced that when death was the end of it. Just before she died, she turned to her son and said, you were right and I'm wrong, and then she died. So they're nice accounts like that. But from my point of view, I can't go beyond that. Yeah. But the dying seem to know.
Yes, this reminds me of something that Kalisosis is what often mentioned, that if you want to know something about dying, what comes after death, you should study people's experience when they are absolutely very close to dying.
Absolutely.
That, because there we are very close, and maybe we get a sort of anticipation, I mean, not from our side, but we get some impressions of the world to come.
Yes.
But he would also say that we should also study children just about when they are becoming sort of aware of their surroundings and beginning to talk, because at that end we may also get some important information about what may have been before. And that is what Stevenson started to do when he was beginning to study children who claim memories of a previous lives, because these children, some of them, they really start to talk about their past life almost as soon as they can speak. And sometimes even they give indications about it before they can speak properly. I remember particularly one girl who, when she was able to speak, she claimed that she had been killed by her husband. She had been strangled and drowned. But before she could talk about this, she would sometimes seem to get very excited, hold her hand around her neck, and she would get like swollen, you know, red in the on the neck, so you could see the veins. And that happened also later when she was able to describe about it, where she would get sort of emotional about it and talk about it, but her throat would get red and swollen. And but you could see that before she was able to talk about it, which I thought was very interesting. And that also comes sometimes with children who who speak about past lives and have birthmarks, that these birthmarks, they are there when they are born. So they form in the embryo before the child is born. So this cannot be in any way culturally dependent. And then later we find out that the person they are speaking about, if and when that is found, that it had died from an injury on the location where they have their birthmark. These birthmark cases are really very striking, like the case of Punima Ekanayaka. She was even usually silent about her case, and I really discovered it first when I read through the proceedings, the court proceeding of the on the driver who killed that person she was believed to have been, because in those proceedings was a post-mortem report. And when I read the post-mortem report, I noticed that it was described the injuries from the accident. The one of the wheels on the bus had gone over her chest here, and the ribs here were all broken, and they stuck into the lungs and so on, and that must have caused the greatest pain to her, probably. Anyway, it was perhaps were a major factor in her death. And there she had massive birthmarks. Very, very strange. But she, when I noticed this, she had never mentioned her birth defect, so I went back to her, and then she had the birth defect there. But then I was told that the parents had noticed it, and they had showed me a little picture of the girl as a baby, and then already then, or then, this birth defect or birthmark was very clear to see.
Thank you. Yeah, I remember the QA sessions in the first talk. We have received a lot of questions. One of them is quite simple, but maybe that's what the common people would like to ask. For those who have, as Dr. Kim mentions about, there's 20% of them, or 10 or 20% of them, have had their rest, could be we sort of could recover. But why someone has near-death experience, why someone has NDE, why not someone has NDE? Why someone will have NDE, the rest don't have this? But
the question is that when you have cardiac arrest patients, only between 10 and 20% have memories of the period of unconsciousness, a report and enhanced consciousness, which we call a near-death experience. And 80 to 90% of these cardiac arrest survivors do not have any memory. And the question is, why is this difference?
Yeah.
That's your question. Mm-hmm. But I have said before that there was no difference at all between those patients who had near-death experience with cardiac arrest and those patients who had a cardiac arrest without. So there was no explanation in physiology. So the duration of cardiac arrest, the duration of unconsciousness. There was no difference in fear of death. There was psychological explanation. There was no difference in medication, so no pharmacological explanation. There was no demographic explanation. So they were totally the same. This, why only 10 to 20% have a near-death experience is a mystery. We don't have a scientific answer. The only thing we can say is all the reasons they have mentioned before as an explanation are false.
Yes.
I think I absolutely agree with Pim. I might not be quite as forceful as he is.
I doubt.
Some people remember it, some people don't. And so, as a scientist, I can ask Pim immediately, did he test the memories of his people? Did you test the memories of your people?
We did the longitudinal study. That means we looked for the transformation. And we know that children who have a near-death experience under the age of 4, most do not remember that they have a near-death experience. In our study also, we found a patient who had a near-death experience that significantly more had a near-death experience as a child. And it happened to be that during the near-death experience as an adult, during cardiac arrest, that at that moment they realized that they had a near-death experience as a child, but they didn't know, they didn't remember it. But what is striking is that all those children who don't remember the near-death experience all had transformation. All they had enhanced intuitive sensibility. They all had intuition, they all had, let's say, healing hands, whatever they had kind of. So for me, the transformation is a kind of objective criteria for the fact that they had this experience. And when they don't have the transformation, I doubt if they had this experience, but they cannot prove it.
Yes, I think Pim's point is a very good one, and that is that you can tell who has it because they transform. And those who don't transform don't have it. So are we talking about a group of patients who don't actually get it, rather than a group of patients, all of whom get it, but only a few of whom can remember it? And the question that I was asking him was, has he tested the memory of these people formally? To see whether it is a memory factor that you can measure. It doesn't have to be, but could it be a memory factor? And the other thing one can think about is, do these people who have near-death experience have a particular type of brain damage, which leads to personality change on the one hand, the expression of it on the other? In other words, is there something about the cardiac arrest that kills off or alters a particular part of the brain? Now, that is a very reductionist explanation, but I think what one needs to do, like Pim has got rid of a whole lot of other explanations, one needs to get rid of this. So one needs to do proper neuropsychological tests on the whole cohort and see whether there is a difference between them.
We had found one interesting thing, that people had been in coma for weeks and still had, so we had to postpone our first interview. Normally we did it within days. But then those patients who had problem with the short-term memory, cognitive function problems, they have significant less near-death experiences. So what we found is that you need a good functioning memory to report it. So those people who had damaged brains had less chance to remember the NDE. That's the only thing we really found.
Yes. So it may be a memory factor.
I think it's likely to be, just like with sleep and dreams, that if you wake people up during a REM period, all of them have dreams and remember something, but not so many will remember anything in the morning. So it seems that what occurs to us when we are a bit, say, unconscious from the seen from the outside, that all of that gets wiped away.
Mm-hmm. I don't believe at all what you say, because all people who had a near-death experience say, this experience is totally different from a dream. I have hardly ever...
No, he's
memory.
Using it as an analogy.
I'm not saying, of course it's different from a dream,
but
the memory factor may be similar.
Yes.
So that's the reason we did the longitudinal study, to find out.
Yeah.
Yes.
But it shows also that when you interview them later, few of them remember.
It was when they had been unconscious for weeks.
Yes.
We couldn't do the interview after 2 days because we were still unconscious.
Yes. So
and then those patients who had been conscious for weeks and had a good short-term memory, they have the same percentage of NDEs. But those patients who had a less functioning short-term memory, but there had been some patients, they had a less chance to have an NDE. That's what statistical finding.
You see, I like what Hernandez does say, because the argument could be that in the unconsciousness is not the same for everybody. Although we say it is, it may not be. And so you could argue that there are subsystems within the brain, if you like, the amount of acetylcholine which is released during unconsciousness enhances memory in some patients, and it's not secreted to the same amount by the failure of the oxygen supply in another group. It may be something like that. But what do I really believe? Do I believe that people who are clinically dead all will have a near-death experience? I think it's very difficult to argue against that if one is seeing them. Near-death experience is something which is fundamental. It's a fundamental level of consciousness. It's a fundamental level of consciousness that you approach when you're clinically dead. And I use the word clinically dead, not really dead, but clinically dead. And so you either have to argue for special factors which protect 80% from getting it, or you have to say that 80% don't reach it, and then it's not such a fundamental level of consciousness, it's something different. So I think my belief is probably they all do, they don't all report it.
I have different beliefs. The transformation, which is an important factor for me.
Mm. Yes.
Did you ever meet a patient with NDE who did not show the transformation?
No.
That's what I mean. Mm.
But then what you're arguing, if I'm correct, is that some people don't go deep enough in there. Clinical death state to approach an NDE which will transform them. So you're going to have different levels here which people don't go down to, rather than a factor within the brain which allows its manifestation.
But there's no, I don't have a scientific explanation why only 10% have the NDE. But an explanation could be that each people have a kind of connection between the physical body and consciousness. I mean, you get rid of this connection. within 5 to 10 minutes, you will report in the in your clinical death because you're resuscitated within minutes. But people need more time to get lose this tight connection between the physical body and consciousness. Perhaps they need 30 minutes or 1 hour.
Okay.
Then they will not report it any because they were still in
yes.
the body. So that it's not science what I'm telling. But
no,
it
no.
could be an explanation.
Yes. But here we're into hypothesis.
Yes,
we don't
exactly.
know, so,
exactly.
we have to
so
say
that's
that.
That's what I say. It's not science, but it could be an explanation.
But your argument is that the two ones, does everybody have it, but people can't report it for some reasons, as opposed to people not going deep enough. The deep enough one is the one you choose, but you don't use the word deep. You use disconnection instead of death.
Because there are some people having the death experience, which is only one or two elements and not a deep
absolutely.
Core experience. But they just have, they're out of the body, they have an out of body perception and go back.
Mm.
And they still have the transformation as well. So you don't need a deep near death experience. There's a lot of elements which is called a core experience, you know, with a lot of elements to report, to have this transformation. So I don't call it a deep. I think the moment you have an experience of consciousness disconnected from your physical body.
Yes, that's what I was saying. You're using disconnection,
yeah.
and I was using deep. In fact, it actually doesn't matter what the terminology is,
yeah.
but essentially what we're saying is that some people don't reach it, rather than everybody reaches it,
yeah.
but some people don't remember it. So I think that's...
Seems to depend on how much of this experience they can bring into their daily conscious life.
Yeah.
But maybe most of them, or all of them have it, but... They just,
no, he argues that they don't.
Pardon?
He argues that they... That they don't have
yes.
it.
Course
if they
of
did
the
have it, then they would.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand you well when you were talking about dreams. I thought you were compared with that, which was wrong for me. But about the having not the death, I don't have an explanation, still don't. But my assumption is that it's
hypothesis.
Yeah. Just final one question. Now, with all those empirical findings, case analysis, and proof of evidence, that so many researchers, just like your good selves, have been collected for more than 30 years by now. Now, what kind of theoretical and or practical implications these will have to offer to our human conditions and to the whole of human civilization? Please enlighten us on this.
Yes, I think the first one, which I think is enormously important, is the fact that they occur and they show extended consciousness. Like this is enormously important. In other words, the consciousness we have now in our everyday state is just a limited form of consciousness. The next point is that by experiencing these wider states of consciousness, you transform people. And so anything which will lead to transformation of people, and it's always along a particular dimension, it is more socially aware, it's more spiritual, etc., it's more concerned. With society as a whole, has to be beneficial for the society. So I think that's enormously important. The other one, which I think is absolutely vital, is it's beginning to eat away at the mechanical view of that we have since the 17th century, really. That man was a clock, and it ticked, and then it ran out of wind and stopped, and that was it. Now what it's showing is that man actually may not be a clock, he may be a living element of the universe and expresses the universe through himself. And it's this view of us not being something which just ticks along and stops, but in fact is part of the ability to express the whole divine range of the universe, which is going to be so important. So I think the near-death experience has all those factors to it.
I totally agree. But the practical point of view is that we also can perhaps talk about the fear of death.
Yes.
The death is still a huge taboo, also in healthcare. We doctors fight against death, but when you have a different view, the treatment of patients in coma, dying patients, perhaps also organ transplantation with the definition of brain death, euthanasia, whatever kind of things, will have practical implications for our daily practice. The fear of death also makes a lot of people have fear of living as well. And what Peter said, it's when you realize that everything is always connected, that everything is one, that everything you do for others will ultimately come back to you in positive and negative way. If you realize that each thought you ever had, even as an intention, will have effect on yourself and others, if you know that, the way you live will change. And then when you want to change the world, you have to change your own consciousness. And that is the first step to change.
Yeah, I like that.
Well, well, the theoretical consequence of these findings, well, I think these are new findings, and they're very important findings, and they have the potential to change many things and our views about many things. And they also are points towards that there is life after death. So these are theoretical consequences. Well, about the practical ones, well, like fear of death, that you mentioned, is certainly important. And then I come again to think about colored sources, that I remember when we're giving our talks to the medical staff in the hospitals in India, he mentioned sometimes that we need a new school in our educational system. We all go to primary school, middle school, and some go to university, and so on and so forth. But one final school is missing, and that is the school of how to die, as how to prepare for death, and where we should come to know a lot of things, not only about the physical death of the body, but various approaches to dying, and about the phenomena that point towards that might be light after death. Also about the like near-death experiences, what they tell us about those who are about to die, what they become aware of. These are all important things. So it would be important to increase what we might call death education, mm-hmm. how people die, what to expect, what do we know, what points in a certain direction. So this is all, these are all practical consequences and really should be pursued further so that it would reach the general public.
Yes. Especially when we are in an ever-increasing aging population in the whole world.
Yeah. I love the quote to you, what you said, is our ideas about death define how we live our life. And that's when we think the death at the end of everything,
yeah.
we have the materialistic approach in life, yeah. where we believe that death is a continuation of consciousness. And there's interconnectedness with everything on earth. We have a different kind of life.
I think that's right.
Then I think we should also remember that in a way we die every night. We lose consciousness, we fall asleep. No one is fearful of it. More the other way around, they are worried till we come to sleep. So why shouldn't we approach death the same way? That's just suddenly we are not aware of ourselves, at least on this side. So why worry about it? That's just a natural thing, just like sleeping.
Right.
And
that's what the Tibetan Buddhists are saying, that sleeping is only one kind of battle, one of the transitional
periods.
It's a short death.
It's essentially the same process, perhaps, except, of course, that our body keeps living.
Yes.
So, and then in the final analysis, of course, consciousness is the greatest mystery. We cannot understand that consciousness. Someone liken it, I remember like we will never know sort of what we really are, because every liken us to light, you can never use a light to lift up your own light.
Mm.
That's not possible. So our background, our real essence, that evades us. I think it will always evade us somehow. That's the great mystery. That's perhaps the void there. The nothingness. Mm-hmm. Yes.
I think for me, the most important thing is this. We're afraid of death, and many cultures have done everything they can, and particularly our cultures now, to get away from death. We have lost touch with the fact that we are biological, and that death is just part of birth. And if we really understood that we were liable to die, we would do what the saints do. They roll up their sleeping clothes, put it in the corner, and expect not to come back that day. Now just think, because they may die, now just think what effect that would have on the culture. You can't have enemies if you know you're going to die that day. You don't have enemies. Just think, you can't be greedy, because there's no point in being greedy and accumulating things if you know you're going to die that day. You can't be unloving to people, because if you know you're going to die that day, you naturally turn outwards to other people. So it produces a huge change in our culture. And I sincerely hope that one of the things we might be able to do is to teach people an awareness of death, so as Pim says, they can live and live properly.
Yes. Also, like Carlos used to say, that prepare for death, and then also sort of unloosen the ties, like you were mentioning, greed and this and that and that, and realize that this is all very temporal and really rather unimportant.
Mm-hmm.
So dissolve from these ties gradually, and then you become freer, without, of course, loosening your responsibility and all of that, but get more distance to all these things, and then you will have an easier death, I think.
We also don't realize that our physical body is not a permanent thing. Each second, 250,000 cells die and are being replaced. Each day, 50 billion cells die and are being replaced. Each year, about a year, you have a new body. And when you look to molecules and atoms, each 10 to 40 days you have new molecules and blood body. But when you look to the smallest particles in your body, they change each, well, billions of a second. So there is a continuation of change in your body on all levels. And we believe that this body is permanent, which is totally only continuous aspect of who we are is our consciousness, with also changing concepts and changing thoughts and changing ideas. But behind all these ideas, there's the absolute light, enlightenment, absolute non-local consciousness.
Do you think possibly we're not meant to know this? Do you think there is a bar somehow which stops us getting to this wisdom? The Zen story, I think, summed it up for me very nicely. It's there's a Zen master called Hakuen, and a student comes up to Mr. Hakuen and says, "Tell me, Master, what happens after death?" And so Hakuen says to him, "Why do you ask me that question?" "Because you are a Zen master," says the student, to which Hakuen replies, "Yes, but not a dead one." So perhaps we'll never.
Well, thank you very much, Danette, for this very enjoyable discussion. We learned a lot, and we hope that we end with a sense of hope and optimism for our future mankind. Thank you very much.